This morning's message I titled Providence Even in Famine. And essentially, give me one quick second here. I'm sorry. I got to do this. Providence Even in Famine. And I'm just going to give you a couple of definitions real quick. First off, regarding the word providence, I kind of came up with my own definition. I mean, I reviewed a dictionary and wanted to make sure that I was on the right track, but this is kind of the way I would describe it. Providence can be described as the invisible hand of God leading and guiding and directing people. And in certain situations, like you, in other words, you're kind of like on your own pathway. You're heading in a certain direction. And there's little things along the way that are happening. And when it's all said and done, you end up in the place where God always intended for you to be. But you could have never imagined that how you would have ended up there. But yet sometimes when it's all said and done and you reflect backwardly, you can see God's hand in the midst of all of these circumstances, and that he intervened along the way, that he allowed certain things to happen for a bigger purpose than what your mind was able to see, because his invisible hand, his omniscient mind, which means all-knowing mind, knew exactly what you were going to do before you were going to do it, knew the choices you were going to make before you made the choices, and that when it was all said and done, even in the midst of your disobedience, my disobedience, God was able to lead, guide, and direct behind the scenes, orchestrating. That's my definition of providence. And you know, certainly the decisions and actions that a person makes can affect our ultimate results, right? Where we ultimately end up. That's called the free will of man. What I'm trying to tell you is that even though God does have providence, even though God is sovereign, and that he does orchestrate, he does control, sometimes man in his own free will is just stubborn and stiff-necked. I'm just telling you what the Bible says. When you review the history of the children of Israel, the Bible says on multiple occasions they were stubborn and stiff-necked. They were hard-hearted. They refused to hearken, which means to listen and obey the word of the Lord. And because they refused to submit to God, will, people oftentimes who loved God end up in the midst of destruction, end up in the midst of situations that no longer can be repaired. It's not that God can't repair, but they were just disobedient to the point where it ended up in destruction rather than the ultimate will for God's, rather than God's ultimate will for our life. But I got to tell you that God still has a way of getting people to the place that he wants them, despite their own best efforts to run in the opposite direction. I'm telling you right now that I can still remember myself. I don't know why I always feel like I gotta tell these stories, but I can still remember being 17 years old, a high school dropout, and staying at this guy's apartment and nowhere to go, and just like living on drugs and alcohol and one sexual relationship after another and just completely empty and nowhere to go. Nothing. Just empty. And how many years before that my sister had told me things about the gospel, you know? And whenever I ultimately ended up back at my sister's house and went to church with them that night and gave my heart to the Lord, and now to see where God, the things that God has done, you know, in my life, when I look backwards, to see where God has brought me. And I don't even really talk a whole lot about the things that God has allowed me to accomplish. You know, I ended up going, getting my GED and then going to nursing school and becoming an RN and going back and get my master's degree and becoming a nurse practitioner, all that kind of stuff. It doesn't always turn out exactly like that. You know what I'm saying? But at the same time, when I reflect backwards at that 17-year-old boy, and the decisions that he was making and how hard he tried to run in the opposite direction of God's will. And sometimes even after being a Christian has run in the opposite direction of God's will. But at the same time, God is sovereign. Amen. And God, his providential hand behind the scenes, moving and operating to get us to a place where he desires for us to be. And so, like Jonah, we keep moving away from God's will, many of us, despite the fact that everything is falling apart around us. But like God, he is persistent in orchestrating circumstances that lead to a type of famine, that drive us back to a place where we can hear his voice more clearly so we can have an opportunity to respond. That leads me to my next thought, talking about famine. The Bible is filled with stories, narratives that describe a famine, that God orchestrates or allows a famine for a bigger purpose that you can't really see behind the scenes. In the Bible, physically what's happening is that there's a famine. Like, for instance, in the time frame of the prophet Elijah, there was a great drought. So there was no water for the animals. There was no water for the crops. There was no food for the people. There was a physical famine that happened. And I can tell you, though, that even in the midst of all of that, there was a famine that happened in Egypt, but God used the famine to promote Joseph. You may not even be familiar with some of these characters, but the main point that I'm trying to tell you is that throughout the pages of Scripture, God has allowed physical famines to take place in order to lead his people in a particular direction that he would have them to go. And what I need you to know is that in a spiritual sense, the same holds true. When there's a drought or a lack in our lives, I'm talking about a missing spot. There's something missing. Trials and tribulations have taken place. We've had loss in the midst of our lives, and it's resulted in a spiritual famine, an emotional famine. We don't have anything left. It's been all taken out of us. We don't know where to go. We don't know what to do. Something's missing, and we begin to feel the need to move in a direction opposite of God's will in order to fill up that need. Listen, the world has all kinds of counterfeit options in order for you to try to fill the void and the needs in your life. You understand what I'm talking about? I mean, look, I don't really necessarily always have to talk about this, but the reason that I do, I guess, is because I'm also in healthcare, and so I know that we live in the most medicated society that's ever been known to humanity. I mean, people are either on antidepressants, anti-anxieties, or else they score in some pain pills from their partner down the street. They're trying to numb their pain, whether it's from alcohol or whether it's from pills or whether it's from whatever it is that they're doing, and they're trying to escape. So they're in the midst of a famine, and they're trying to fill the void. They're trying to fill the empty spot with something that they can get, and it's bringing them in the opposite direction of God's will for their lives and for our lives. But it's not just drugs and alcohol. They can be other things. It can be relationships. People try. They go from relationship to relationship to relationship out of God's will, and it ultimately results in emptiness, and it ultimately results in more famine and more pain. But I need you to know that God does some of his best work in the middle of a famine. Like the story of Joseph and how he used famine to become an opportunity of prosperity in Joseph's life. I want to tell you a story that speaks to both providence and famine this morning. And it's the story of a woman named Ruth. Ruth is the 8th book in the Bible. And it's a very popular book. If you read it on the surface, and if you believe that the Bible is really the whole Bible. I'm talking about from the beginning in Genesis, which means beginnings, all the way to the book of Revelation, which will be the unveiling of Jesus. If you believe that this whole book was written to reveal to humanity God's plan, which was the giving of his son Jesus to die for us so that we can have a relationship with him, if you don't understand some certain things about Ruth, if it's your first time reading the book, you may not understand why is this book in there. But when it's all said and done, I want you to know that it's a very integral part of the Jewish history of the children of Israel's, the people of Israel. And it was very important to them for it to be in their scriptures, because I need you to know that when it's all said and done, Ruth was a very instrumental character in the plan of God. And I'll talk about it at the end, but Ruth she was the grandmother of David. And so, of King David, who was a huge character in Israel's history. King David was a type of Jesus Christ. So in the story, Ruth, it's hard to tell whether the focus should be on the disobedience of Elimelech, who was the character in the story who starts everything moving in the direction where things should not have gone. So it's hard to tell whether or not, whenever you look at the story, should we focus on Elimelech's disobedience and look at the pain that takes place whenever somebody is disobedient? Or should we instead focus on the love of God for this young girl named Ruth, who would have never had an opportunity to know anything about God had Elimelech not been disobedient in that particular situation. It reminded me, to be honest with you, of the Samaritan woman. When I look back at Robert, because we talked about the Samaritan woman, I don't know how many years ago, and it was such a powerful concept that we realized that Jesus went a specific way that nobody else would have ever gone, because the Jews hated the Samaritans, for a specific purpose, to have an encounter with a Samaritan woman who was left isolated, who was left desperate, who had no hope in the world, who was empty, but yet God had a plan for that one woman. And had Jesus not purposefully been led by the Holy Spirit to have an encounter with her, her life would have never been changed. I have to tell you that when I review the book of Ruth, in the past I've always focused on the disobedience of Elimelech. But now I'm focusing on the love that God had toward this young Moabite girl named Ruth. The story takes place in the time frame of the judges, which is after Joshua has led the children of Israel into the promised land. And Joshua now has died. And the Bible says four different times in the book of Judges that at that time there was no king. Two times it says, Judges 17:6, you can put that up there if you want. And two different times it says this right here. In those days, there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyes. See, this is a classic problem with the world and even many Christians today. We're willing to accept Jesus Christ as our Savior. In other words, we don't want to go to hell. We believe the gospel. We believe he died on the cross. If they caught you at a barroom somewhere, like me at a party many, many years ago, and they say something wrong about Jesus, you might be even one of the first ones to say, hold on, stand up for the Lord. You know, make a comment. Don't be talking about Jesus bad in this place. We want him to be our Savior, but we're having a hard time letting him be the king to rule on our hearts. And what I need you to know is this. That was Israel's problem during the time frame of the judges. There was no king. They wanted a king, but they didn't want God to be their king. And so each man did what was right in his own eyes. And so it's in that time frame that in this story, this Elimelech, this man, yeah, I'm just going to tell you the story for the most part. This man named Elimelech, who had a wife named Naomi and had two sons, Mahlon and Chilion. In the midst of the famine, the Bible tells us in the book of Ruth, chapter 1, there was a famine in the land, that he took his family and he journeyed to a place called Moab. God never has an intention for you and I to depart from his presence. No matter what it is that we're going through, no matter what it is that we're facing, the tendency for the enemy in your life is to drive you in a direction away from God, to separate you from the plan of God. But God's will is for you not to disconnect from his presence, for you not to disconnect from fellowship with him, but yet instead, even in the midst of your trial, for you to stay put and to trust him and to wait for him patiently. Amen. The Bible teaches us in the book of Ruth that they stayed in that land for 10 years. It wasn't long after they got there that Elimelech died. So Elimelech, in disobedience, in the time of frame of a famine, takes his whole family, moves to a foreign place, Moab, outside of the will of God, and before you know it, he dies. He leaves his wife and his two sons there by themselves in the midst of a foreign land. His two sons end up marrying two Moabite women. Now, there's a rich history of the children of Israel's men marrying Moabite women. It was a mess, I got to tell you. During the time frame of the Exodus and the wandering in the wilderness, basically, that has to do with the prophet Balaam and the king Balak. And I don't know if you remember the whole story, but Balak wanted this false prophet to curse the children of Israel. God refused to curse his people. So what Balaam taught the children of Israel to do was, he said, it's okay, marry those Moabite women. And what happened was, as the men married the Moabite women, it drew them away to worship false gods. And it ultimately brought a curse on their lives. They curse themselves. What I need you to know is that's why it's so important for the child of God not to enter into a fellowship relationship with darkness. That's why the Bible says, what fellowship does light have with darkness? I'm not just talking about marriage, but I'm talking about close fellowship. You know, there's a difference between being a friend with somebody and fellowshipping with somebody. Somebody that you're fellowshipping with is what you're spending all your time with. You're pouring your heart out to them. You're connecting yourself to them. The Bible says, what fellowship does light have with darkness? And if you allow darkness in long enough, it will begin to quench the light in your life. And I just want to encourage you and let you know that that's exactly what was happening during these time frames. Now, Naomi was left alone, and these two boys had married these two Moabite women, and before you know it, the two boys died too. So now Naomi's left all alone by herself. Her husband's died. Her two sons have died. I can tell you that it doesn't end up being a pretty picture whenever you move away from the presence of God, from the will of God, towards your own destiny in rebellion against the plan of God. Things start happening. More trial, more tribulation, more famine, problem upon problem. God will deem it so. God will orchestrate it to take place that way, so that He, by His sovereign and providential hand, will begin to move you back into the direction that He would have you to go. Now, one of the things that I want you to know is that the town that they had originally left, when they left Israel to go to Moab, the town that they were from was a little town called Bethlehem. Now, the name of this town, Bethlehem, is actually called, the meaning of the Hebrew word Bethlehem means house of bread. An interesting concept that in this town known as the house of bread, there was a famine in the land. One of the things that I need you to know, because there may be times in your walk with God that you may think, you know, I don't hear His voice, I can't feel His presence, there's a famine in the land, I'm not being fed. I got to tell you something. God didn't run out of bread. God doesn't run out of bread. His storehouse is always full. The problem is that sometimes God allows trials and tribulations to take place in our life to test us, to see where we're going to run to see which direction we're going to go in, whether or not we're going to stay and wait and trust Him, or whether or not we're going to venture out and go our own way. They left Bethlehem to go to Moab, but after her husband dies, after her two boys dies, it wasn't very long after that, Naomi heard there was bread back in Bethlehem. And the interesting thing, once again, what I told you was that the name of the Bethlehem means house of bread, and she heard that God was providing for His people again over there in Bethlehem. And so that's whenever they hear that there was bread back in Bethlehem. It should be noted that God's provision never runs out. And once they make it home, so what ends up happening is that Naomi hears there's bread back in Bethlehem, and her two daughter-in-laws begin the journey back with her. But then she turns to them and she says to one of them's name was Orpah, and she says to Ruth, Orpah and Ruth, what are y'all going to do? Y'all are going to follow me back to my house? Because even if the Lord would give me a husband tomorrow, and I had two more sons in 9 months, she doesn't say it exactly like that, but her point is I had two offspring quickly. What are you going to do? Wait for them to grow up so you can marry them? You need to go back to your mom and your daddy's house. There's nothing for you where I'm going. What I need you to know is that in the midst of everything that happened in Naomi's life, she wasn't really happy. She had become, all of this loss had really caused frustration in her, had really caused pain in her, and she was going back a different person than when she had left. And so Orpah, she said, okay, and she took off and she went back to her family, but not Ruth. Ruth said, no, I'm staying with you, and I want your people to be my people. And this was a key concept in Ruth's heart. I want your God to be my God. One of the things that you need to know about Ruth is this, or the Moabite people, was that they believed in a god called Chemosh. Chemosh demanded human sacrifice, child human sacrifice. If you were going to worship Chemosh, you had to offer up your own child in sacrifice to him. These people were completely clueless about the things of God. Now, I have to tell you that in today's society, they're probably... We don't need to get into weird stuff this morning, but there are people that are still into that kind of worship. And you don't have to believe that if you don't want to, but that's not what we're talking about this morning. But what I would like to equate it to is the world. There are people who think they're in false religion. She was in false religion. She, as far as she knew God. But she didn't know anything about the true God of Israel, who ultimately had a plan to send His son Jesus. But when she saw the way that they served God, even though they were in disobedience, there was something about their lives, there was something about the God that they served that made her want to go back with them. What I'm here to tell you today is that even in our society, there's many people that are caught up in religion. There's many people that are caught up in religion and think that they know God, but the reality of it is that they do not have a relationship with God. They do not know the one true God, the one who sent his son Jesus to die for them, and that it's very important that you are, when you're in the midst of the journey, that you're able to tell them about the one true God, even if you are the one that's been in the famine, even if you're the one that's been on the wrong course, even if you're the one that departed from the presence of God and went your own way in order to accomplish, to try to fill the famine in your life, even then, just like God used Naomi, God can use you to speak to someone and to reveal his truth to someone. So Ruth said, I'm going with you. When they got back to Bethlehem, the people of the city were so excited to see Naomi back. And I don't want to get ahead of myself, but Naomi wasn't really all that happy to be back. She was just hungry, and she was ready to get her belly filled, right? And at the time frame that they showed up, it was barley harvest, all right? And God had a specific provision in his law that allowed for poor people, because see, Naomi and Ruth don't have anything. She's lost everything. She lost her husband. She lost her boys. She's a widow left on her own. Now she's got this daughter-in-law, and she's got two mouths to feed, and she doesn't have anything. But God had a specific provision in his law called, what they would do is they would go gleaning. Meaning that whenever they were harvesting, the reapers were harvesting, many times there was certain strands of wheat that was left on the ground behind them. Does that make sense? And so what God would allow the poor people to do is to walk through the field and to glean that which had been dropped. All right? And so basically it was a form of, you could call it a form of food stamps, or you could call it a form of government assistance. But you had to get out there and you had to work for it. And if you couldn't work for it, then guess what? Because you were crippled or whatever your reason, you had to have a family member get out there and to do it. You had to get out there and you could glean what was left over, okay? So it's barley harvest. And this is the time frame that they show up. And this is the plan. It's in the midst of this scenario that God ends up writing this story about Ruth. So Ruth makes the decision when she finds out about this provision that she wants to go in to find a field that she can go glean in. And she tells her mother-in-law, Naomi, I'm going to go find a field to glean in. Now, the Bible says that she ends up in a field of a close relative. His name was Boaz. Now, what I want you to also know is that there was another provision in the law for widows. It was called the kinsman redeemer. And in the kinsman redeemer, what it means is that the closest relative of the man who died could marry his wife and redeem her, and she would become his wife, and she wouldn't have to lose everything, and she would be taken care of. That's how God took care of people. Well, that has a big part to play in the story, because come to find out when it's all said and done, Boaz is actually a kinsman redeemer. He wasn't the closest one, but one of the parts to the deal was is that the kinsman redeemer had to want to buy back the woman who had lost everything. Now, one thing that I want you to know is this, is that the spiritual implication of this story, a big part of it, has to do with Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. If you could go to that real quick. Hebrews chapter 2 verse 14 speaks of Jesus, and it speaks of the cross. It says, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. What are you trying to say? What does this have to do with kinsman redeemer? A kinsman is one that's kindred. That's where the word kin comes from. The kindred, the kin. Jesus because you and I were flesh and blood. He was the eternal Word that lived in heaven before He ever became flesh. He became flesh. It means He became humanity. He became our kin. He became our brother. He became flesh and blood. Why? So that He could purchase back our souls unto God. Because see, God created man in His own image and likeness, but man and Adam went the wrong way, and all of Adam's offspring was born with sin and separated from God because of sin. So God had a plan that would ultimately send Jesus to die on the cross to purchase back. Jesus ultimately is our kinsman redeemer. Amen. And I need you to know that that's a big connection in this story, spiritually speaking, between Boaz and Ruth. See, Ruth would be you and I. Ruth would be you and I. The people who don't know anything about God. The people who were out there and had somebody not come and told us the truth. We were separate. We were isolated. We were away from God. But then we heard the truth of the gospel and we responded by faith. And when we did, we became united. Really, we became married too. I mean, the Bible's full of that terminology. Matthew 25, Romans chapter 7. We became married to our kinsman redeemer. He became us so that He could redeem us. Now, if you'll go to Ruth chapter 1, we're going to read verses 1 through 6. I wanted you to see my first point. My first point is titled Decision of Departure. And we're going to read Ruth 1, 1 through 6. Now, it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and the name of his two sons Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem, Judah. They came into the country of Moab and continued there, and Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left, and her two sons. And they took them wives of the women of Moab, the name of the one was Orpah, the name of the other Ruth, and they dwelled there about 10 years. And Mahlon and Chilion died also, both of them, and the woman was left of her two sons and her husband. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law, that she might return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab how that the Lord had visited His people in giving them bread. So there was a famine that caused them to leave God's presence. After they left, there was great loss, and after the loss, there was provision in the same place they had been before, whenever they were in God's will. What I need you to know, one thing that I need you to know, this is talking about departing from His presence, a decision to depart from the presence of God. Many times when we're faced with famine, once again, this is one of the first things that we do. We go looking outside of God's will for something, and in the end of that journey, and when we come to the final place of emptiness, what we realize is that we should have never left the place that we originally were. And what God is desiring to do is, He's trying to get us back to the place where we originally started when we were in God's will. So maybe there's somebody in here this morning, just because you had a church house doesn't mean that you've gone back to the place where God would have had you to go to. Maybe the fact of the matter is this, is that we all need to look back to, where was it that I left Your will when I was in Your will to begin with? Because that's the place that I need to get back to. That I need to look to You. I need to repent. I need to ask You to forgive me for my failure toward You and my movement away from You. And I need to get back to that place. And really with that place of Bethlehem, it's the house of bread, it's a place of provision, it's a place where God will feed you, but it's a place of where you're back in the will of God. It's a place where things between you and the Lord are right. And the only way that that can be right is when your faith is properly placed in Jesus. And not just who He was, but what He did. And to understand that Him and His sacrifice and your faith in that makes you right with God. And that whenever you ventured in the wrong way, to make it right with God, to bear your heart to Him and to let Him know. And repentance isn't just, I'm sorry, Lord. No, repentance is, Lord, I'm sorry that I ventured out of the wrong, out of Your will. Lord, I need You to do a work in my heart. Sometimes it starts off with just a prayer. Sometimes it starts off with just a prayer because you can't change it. You can't fix it. You got to cry out to God and say, Lord, I've departed. I made a decision to depart, but I need to get back to your will. You know, I got to tell you, this isn't the first time that this happened in the Bible, and it won't be, there's multiple times, and if it's ever happened to you, it probably won't be the last. There's multiple times that people, for whatever their reason, decide to depart. I remember the story of Abraham and Lot. I don't know if y'all remember that story much, but there was a time frame in Abraham and Lot's life where God blessed them so much. Because, I mean, in the story we're talking about, there was a famine. But sometimes people, it's a famine that causes them to depart from the presence of God. But sometimes whenever people are doing good, they depart from the presence of God. I've seen it happen. I don't understand it. They're in a bad spot. I don't want to speak too pridefully, because the truth is that the Lord might allow me to go through a test like that. But here you are. Some people are in a famine spot, and they depart from the presence of God to try to get God to fix it. But then some people are being blessed by God. They were in a famine. God blessed them. He rearranged their life for them. You know what I'm saying? You ever come to God broke, busted, and disgusted? And all of a sudden, He builds you up. He gives you a foundation. He gives you a job. He gives you a promotion. He starts putting money in your bank account. And all of a sudden, it's like, man, I've arrived. Now I'm going to decide to depart. He's giving me all this stuff. Maybe I'm going to head in another direction and do what I want to do. And that's what happened in Abraham and Lot's life. Their flocks had grown so much. They were herdsmen. They were shepherds. And their men were quarreling amongst one another. And they had to go their separate ways. He had been following his uncle Abraham. Abraham was following the voice of God. Abraham said, we're going to have to go in separate ways. You go ahead and take whatever you desire to take. You know what the Bible says about that story? I don't need you to know the whole thing, but this is what I want you to know. Lot surveyed the land. Sensually, with his eyes, he took a visual of what was going on around him. The Bible says that the plain of Jordan was well watered. You know what that means? It was green. See, a plain that's well watered is green. You know what green grass means to a shepherd? This is the place I need to be. But the problem is that if he would have looked a little harder, he would have also noticed that near that plain, in the direction he was headed, was a place called Sodom, the world. The world full of wickedness, the world full of evil, the world full of the party. Listen, you want some Sodom, go ahead on Tuesday. You can go get you some. I'm not afraid to tell you that isn't of the Lord. That right there is of the world. That is not of Jesus. Jesus didn't die so that you could go out there and worship false gods on some kind of parade. Oh, come on, preacher. You're living in the old days. No, I'm here to tell you the truth. It's called revelry, and it's a worship of the god Bacchus, who was the god of wine and revelry. Don't tell me. I've been out there. I drank plenty of it. I indulged in plenty of it. I'm here to tell you that if you're a new creation in Christ, that He desires to kill the old, and He wants to replace the new with new desires, new hope, new love. Amen? That's the plan of God. And the reality is this. Sometimes whenever you say stuff like that, it causes something real frustrating to rise up on the inside of your spirit, man. Guess what? That ain't me. That's not me doing that to you. And I'll be honest with you, it's not the Holy Spirit doing it to you either. Because the Holy Spirit is saying, the boy's right, you know. He's telling you the truth. But what the enemy will do is, how dare he tell me? I don't have a conviction over that. Well, you know what? Maybe your conscience is seared. The Bible says your conscience can become seared. And what I'm here to tell you is that I don't have time to get into all that. I didn't even plan on even talking about that. But I can prove it from the scriptures that what I'm telling you is true. That is a spirit of another kind that is not the Holy Spirit, and it results in things that are ungodly. Therefore, it is not in the will of God. Yeah. All right. If Lot would have noticed what was down there, he would have realized where he was headed. The Bible says that he ended up near Sodom. He pitched his tent towards Sodom. And the next thing you know, he's in the city. He's doing transactions in the city. He's part of it. It seems like he's on the council, because that's where the leaders of the city were. And he was right there in the midst of all of them. The point that I'm trying to make is that when you depart from the presence of God, whether it's because there's a famine or whether or not it's because you think God has blessed you, but you move away from God's will and you move towards your own will, and that step takes you a little bit closer to the world, you may find yourself in a situation and in a spot that you never intended on being. And you don't even realize that you're in a big old mess. Amen. But God is merciful enough to let his people know there's destruction coming. Sodom was destroyed. I'm here to tell you there's judgment coming. There's judgment coming on the world. There's judgment coming on disobedience. But good news, God provided a payment for your judgment. It was in Jesus. But don't let yourself be fooled thinking, oh yeah, I believe in Jesus. No, he doesn't want a piece of your heart. He wants your whole heart. He wants you to come to him. He wants you to submit to his will. There was another time too for Abraham. Abraham's was more like Elimelech and Naomi's situation. See, God had given him a promise that he would have a seed. And that through that seed, he would make a great nation. And ultimately, we know when we read the Bible that through that nation, we got Jesus. But there was a time whenever Abraham was 99, Sarah was 90, and it seemed hopeless. There was a famine. There was something missing. And so what they did was they tried to make it happen in their own strength, according to their own wisdom. And Abraham went and lied with their bond slave woman, Hagar. And they produced a child named Ishmael, which is where the Muslim religion now has come from. What I'm here to tell you is this, is that they went off and they did it their own way. And it caused pain. It caused negative circumstances. But God, even though there's a famine in the land and it may seem like there's no hope because you can't see, hear, or feel God, you cannot move away from him because he's the only one that can provide. It's a matter of timing. That's what I need you to know. When you're in the midst of a famine and you don't feel the presence of God like you used to, you don't hear the voice of God like you used to, it's a matter of timing. You don't want to rush off and move away from God. You want to sit and you want to try to wait on the Lord. There's a scripture out of Lamentations. Lamentations chapter 3, verses 24 through 25. Lamentations is an Old Testament book that was written by the prophet Jeremiah. This is what he said. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore will I hope in him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. You know, what I got to tell you that whenever I read scriptures like this, I kind of try to stop and ponder them. You know, instead of just reading them and going through fast, I try to stop and ponder on them. And I started to think, what does it even mean to say that the Lord is my portion? You know, a portion describes an inheritance. It describes in this passage of scripture that he's what I get to inherit. What it's talking about is this. He is ultimately the goal. He is ultimately my inheritance. Everything else on this temporary world, as much as it tries to please me and fulfill me, is not the end goal, but he is, and the ability for me to be able to have a relationship with him and to believe that there's an eternity past this temporary circumstance that I can be one with him in and have an eternal relationship with him. It has to mean something because that's the promise that God is giving. Yet at the same time, because we can't see it, because we can't feel it, because we can't hold on to it, we instead want something else to be our portion. We want more money to be our portion. We want better vehicles to be our portion. We want better houses to be our portion. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with better vehicles and better houses. What I'm saying is, all that stuff's going to burn up. We need the Lord to make it real in our hearts that he is our portion, that he is the thing that our hearts desire and long for. That way, if we end up in the midst of a famine, that way, if we end up in the midst of emptiness, we'll realize, hey, this is a temporary time, but yet God is eternal. I got to hold on. He says, I will hope in him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for him. To the soul that seeks him. So when you find yourself in a famine, hold on to the Lord. Seek his face. Amen. And hold on. Point number two. The first point was this. It was a decision for departure. I'm in a famine. I'm moving in the wrong direction because I'm trying to fix something. I'm trying to make something happen for myself. Point number two is the battle of bitterness. See, that's what happens. Whenever you depart from the presence of God and you go out on your own and the Lord's not your portion and you're looking for something else to be your portion and you begin to see the negative circumstances like they happened in Naomi's life, her husband dies, her two boys die, then guess what? One thing after another, things keep compounding, things keep happening, and before you know it, bitterness can become a part of your life. Ruth chapter 1, verses 19 through 22. So they too, talking about Ruth and Naomi, went until they came to Bethlehem. And it came to pass that when they were come to Bethlehem, that all the city was moved about them, and they said, Is this Naomi? And she said unto them, call me not Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. You see that? The Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord has brought me home again empty. Why then call ye me Naomi, seeing the Lord has testified against me, and the Almighty has afflicted me? So Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, with her, which returned out of the country of Moab, and they came to Bethlehem in the beginning of barley harvest. When you step outside of God's will, you won't get what you're looking for. If you do get what you want, it won't be what you thought it would be, and it will result in disappointment, which often breeds bitterness. She wanted her name to be changed from Naomi to Mara. The name Naomi means pleasant. When she left Bethlehem, her name meant pleasant. Life is pleasant. There's a famine in the land, but guess what? I still got a relationship with God. Things are still pleasant. But whenever she went to the place where she wasn't supposed to go, when she made her decision for departure, and all of the bad things started happening, in her mind, she wants to turn around and blame it on God. She said, look what the Almighty has done to me. Look what God did. He afflicted me. Don't call me Naomi Pleasant. Call me Mara. My life has turned to bitterness. See, the name Mara comes from the time frame also of the Exodus. When the children of Israel were led out through the Red Sea, the first place they came to drink water, they found out the water was bitter. And God told them to cut down a tree and to throw it in the water, a type of the cross. Life is bitter. This world is bitter. And the circumstances that you face are going to remain bitter till you allow the cross, a type of the cross, to be thrown in the midst of your life, amen, to bring change. Listen, the cross, that tree which represented the cross, made the bitter water sweet. They called that place Mara because the waters were originally bitter. She's saying, I want my life, my name, to be called bitter. Listen, this is a plan of the enemy. I'm here to tell you right now, it's a plan of the enemy. He wants to cause, while God has a plan for your life and he allows famines to take place, the enemy is right there like a dog on a chain waiting to get one more inch so that he can flip the script and turn it from a test to a destruction. Where God wanted you to stay and wait on him to receive his provision, the enemy wants you to venture out to go to another place, and then once you're outside of the will of God, to wreak havoc in your life and to cause all kind of pain to take place and to cause your heart to become bitter, and so that you'll turn against the Almighty and you'll start blaming him. Hold on a second, Hoss. God never told you to leave to begin with. God never told you to depart from his presence. That was a choice that you made in the midst of the famine, thinking that you were going to find provision elsewhere, and it didn't result the way that you wanted it to result. But not only will the enemy try to cause bitterness to take place between you and God, that's the worst kind, he'll also try to cause bitterness between you and other people. You'll find yourself in a situation and you'll start blaming everybody else for your circumstances. Everybody else but your own decisions. You'll look around and you'll see everybody else's fault, but you won't be able to see your own. The enemy is a master at causing a root of bitterness to get inside of people's hearts. You start looking around and you start blaming others. I'm here to tell you, that's a dangerous place to be. When bitterness gets into your heart and it begins to harden your heart, it begins to drive a wedge between you and the Lord. The harder your heart is, the harder it becomes for you to be able to feel the presence of God. Your heart becomes desensitized. I don't know. What is it? You know, Robert tells a story. I mean, we can cut it out if you want me to later. Just let me know. He tells a story about before he knew the Lord. And he was in a business partnership. And he found out in the midst of all of that, that some bad things were going on. And his heart became hard, bitter, driving him to the point, I'm not going to say the whole story, but driving him to the point that thoughts in his mind began to take over. And he was going to remedy the situation. And it wasn't real pretty. He had planned it out. That's what bitterness does. Bitterness will reach in and it will begin to cause major destruction, and it will begin to pull you away once again, drive a wedge between you and God, desensitize your heart to the love of God, to the presence of God. And God help us, because we don't even know what's really in us until we are moved away from and desensitized to the voice of God, to the presence of God. He's the only one that knows what we're capable of doing and the wickedness of a man's heart. Naomi wanted to blame God and the children of Israel. Whenever all that happened, they were angry with God and Moses. Wanted to blame Moses. What in the world you brought us out of this wilderness for? The first place we go to drink, the water's bitter. And so that's what the enemy will do in your life. When you make a decision for departure and all things start going bad, next thing you know, he will try to get you bitter towards everyone and even towards God. But I need you to know that there's safety at home. That's point number three. When we're in the midst of a famine, we often make a decision to depart. When we depart, we got to understand that there is a battle over bitterness that takes place. But we need to know this, that there's always safety at home. Ruth chapter 2, verse 12. The Lord recompense thy work, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord, God of Israel, under whose wings thou art come to trust. What you need to know is that in this particular chapter, what this is talking about, this is Boaz. Boaz, the kinsman redeemer. Boaz, the field that Ruth, remember Ruth told her mother-in-law, she said, hey, I heard about this gleaning thing. I'm going to find me a field. I'm going to go into this field, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to start looking for, I'm going to go get us some wheat, some barley. And so she shows up in this field, and Boaz shows up a little bit later because he owns everything. All of his, he's got his foreman out there, and all of the reapers are out there. And they got other women that are coming up behind and gathering up things and bringing water and food. I mean, it's a big old operation that's taking place, and Boaz is the owner, and he walks up and he just kind of scans the situation. How's things going today? Looks like y'all are getting a lot accomplished here. And all of a sudden, he's like, who's that girl right there? He could see her because the Bible doesn't tell you, but it's obvious through the context. She's working, well, for lack of better words, she's working her hiney off. And he's like, man, who's that girl? Look at her, man. Oh, that's the girl that came back with Naomi. Oh, really? I heard about her. Man, look at her hard work. Look at all the effort she's putting in. So he ends up waiting until she's kind of by herself, and he walks up to her. This is the owner of the field. He goes, hey, young lady, I need you to know something. You're welcome to glean in this field. You don't have to go to another field where it might be dangerous, where people might take advantage of you. You stay right here. You stay close to my men that are working. You stay close to the ladies that are working here. You take as much as you want. Then on the side, he tells his reapers, he says, hey, I want you to drop some stuff on purpose for this girl. Don't let her just get one stalk here, but I want you to kind of drop a few bundles her way so that she really gets a blessing, see? And he says, you stay here, we'll feed you, we'll give you plenty of water. You're welcome in my field. But this is what I wanted you to see. There's safety at home because look what the Lord, look what Boaz told her. After he told her all that, he says this. He says, the Lord recompense your work, Ruth. Not just your work of how hard you are and diligent you are in the field, but the decisions that you made to come back with Naomi. And look what he says. And a full reward given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you are come to trust. You might not know a whole lot about him, Ruth. You made a decision back in Moab to follow your mother-in-law back to this country, and you might not know a whole lot about it, but you made a choice to serve the God of Israel. And I got to tell you some things that I've learned about this God. He has some wings that he wants to tuck you under. He's got some wings that he wants to shelter you under, and you have learned to trust in him, and he's about to provide for you. He's about to provide warmth for you, protection for you. He's about to provide nourishment for you. I want you to know that there's safety at home. When you find yourself in the departure and you find yourself battling bitterness, you need to know that there's safety if you just come back home. Amen? The way it says, a big part of Ruth's decision to go back with Naomi once again was that she wanted Naomi's God to be her God. It says that in Ruth chapter 1 verse 16. And Ruth said, entreat me not to leave thee or return from following after thee. For where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people and your God, my God. And now in verse 12, Boaz says, this is the God you chose to serve. He's one that wants to take you under his wings and he wants to protect you. I got to tell you that this isn't the first time. This is a common imagery in the whole scripture. The imagery of under the wings, it's like a place of a shadow of protection, a place of refuge. It describes a place of shielding and protection. Psalm 91, 1 through 4. It says, he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler. I remember I preached on that snare of the fowler one time. We're getting close to the end of the message. Y'all can hang with me. I remember one time I preached on the snare of the fowler. And you know what a fowler was? It was a person who snared birds. That was his living, his occupation. Okay, just like, you know, people will be trappers and they'll set traps out in the woods. Well, they had snares for birds. And so what they would do is they would put a noose out there, and they'd have some kind of intricate system with some kind of noose, and they would feed it. You know, they would put seed, and they'd get the bird to come over, get closer and closer to the noose, till the fowler has him now, his prey. And so God's protection, He uses the imagery. That's what the enemy is wanting to do. He's wanting to, just as the fowler wants to get the bird out of the right place of safety towards the trap and danger, the enemy of your soul also, in the midst of circumstances, wants to get you away from the presence of God into a place of danger where he can finally tighten up the noose, snatch you up, and ultimately separate you from God. But what Boaz is telling Ruth, hey, the God that you came to trust, he wants to cover you up under his wings. That's what it says at the end of here. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler, from the noisome, I mean stinky, pestilence or sickness. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. That means a big shield and a small shield. His truth, his word, is going to protect you. God wants to bring you under his wings, under the feather of his wings. This is the imagery of a hen with her chickens. A hen with her chicks, covering them, keeping them warm, protecting them. Sometimes in our manly mindset, we're like, I don't need no chicken to cover me. I don't need no hen to... No, let me tell you something. You think that? You think you're on your own? No, you need the protection of the Lord in your life. Amen? Because Robert used to say this all the time. If God would remove his hand just a little bit and allow a flood of the enemy's work to enter into your life, you'll know real quick how bad you need God, because you can't get free from that. If the Lord doesn't protect us, amen, we're going to be in a whole world of hurting. We need the Lord's protection. Look, Matthew chapter 23, verse 37. We're talking about their safety at home. This is what Jesus told Jerusalem, the prophets. He said, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you that kill the prophets and stone them which are sent unto you, how often would I have gathered your children together, even as a hen gathers her chickens under her wings, and you would not. God is desiring to gather his people together, to protect them, to place a shield of protection over them, that they would be in his will, that they would be in his presence. But also there's many times whenever people refuse to come to the Lord, when they refuse to hear the voice of God. I'm closing with point number 4, the providence of God. There's no doubt that when we are in the famine, it's often difficult to see the hand of God in it all. Yet when we take the time to look back, we can definitely see how God was involved in the details every step of the way. Even though I went here, he knew it. And even though I went there, he still did this. That's the providential hand of God. That's God moving and operating in our lives. Ruth chapter 2, verse 3. It says, and she went and came and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And her hap was to light on a part of the field belonging unto Boaz, who was of the kindred of Elimelech. You see that word hap right there? The word hap talks about the idea of fate or something that was unexpected but was destined to be. The world may think that it's all about luck. Oh, look at this, man. The luck of the Irish hit me and I just fell right in the right spot at the right time. But for the child of God, we understand God orchestrates everything. Amen. He orchestrates everything. He orchestrated the famine. He orchestrated the whole situation. I'm about to prove it to you at the end of the story that God was planning thousands of years in advance for, even in the midst of Elimelech's disobedience, for this young Moabite girl to end up in Bethlehem, but not just Bethlehem, in the field of Boaz for a specific purpose, because of the fact that Boaz, who was of the kindred of Elimelech. And when we look backwards at this whole scenario, can we possibly think that God wasn't behind the scenes, maneuvering, operating, allowing things to happen for a bigger purpose, to bring you, to bring I, to bring Ruth, Boaz together, to allow situations to happen, to bring us to the place where he desires for us to be. Look at Matthew chapter 1, verses 5 and 6. Does anybody know what Matthew chapter 1 is all about? The context? You just want to spit it out there real quick? I'll spit it out for you. Matthew chapter 1 is all about the genealogy of Jesus. The whole chapter is saying this one begat that one begat that one, and it's bringing us to where Jesus came from. So one of the things that I want you to see in Matthew chapter 1 verses 5 and 6 is Salmon begat Boaz of Rahab. It's spelled a little bit different in the New Testament. Boaz begat Obed of Ruth. Obed begat Jesse. Jesse begat King David. And whenever we continue to follow it through, what we're going to see is that Jesus came from the lineage of King David. So what I need you to know is this, is that the providential hand of God knew that the famine was going to take place, knew that Elimelech was going to leave, and that his sons were going to connect themselves to a Moabite girl named Ruth, knew that their boys were going to die, and that Ruth was going to make a choice to serve the God of Naomi, knew that Ruth was going to come back to Bethlehem, the house of bread, and that she was going to end up, according to the providence of God, in a field of a man named Boaz, who was a next of kindred to Elimelech's people. He ends up marrying Ruth. When it's all said and done, he plays the part of the kinsman redeemer, just like Jesus played the part of the kinsman redeemer for us. He connects himself to Ruth, has offspring with her, and from her comes great King David, who Israel continues even to this day, he's spoken of. And ultimately, Jesus will come back and rule and reign on the throne of David, is what the scripture talks about. But I also need you to know this. God also knew in his providential mind, through his providential hand, that there would one day be a famine in your life. That there would one day be a famine in your life, and I'm talking about a spiritual famine. Because of the fact that you were born of Adam and that you were separated from God and that there was an emptiness in your life, that you were going to come to a place where you were hungry. Where you were hungry for something, and that all of the things that you had been trying to eat were leaving you empty and leaving you disappointed. But yet God had a plan for a place called Bethlehem, the house of bread, where he would allow the birth of Jesus to take place. And the word of God says this, John chapter 6 verse 51. Jesus says, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Jesus is the ultimate bread. Born in Bethlehem, thousands of years later, born in Bethlehem, to quench, to stop a spiritual famine in the hearts of people's lives. Jesus is equating his ministry. Look what he said. He said, I am the bread of life which came down from heaven. Any man that eats shall live forever. And the bread that I give is my flesh. What do you think he means? Ultimately, the bread that he's given is connected to his sacrifice on the cross. And just listen to me. It's hard for us to wrap our mind around this. I used to love it whenever Lauren Larson would say this. I used to just love it. I would quote it all the time. It just makes no sense to the logical mind. What are you talking about, preacher? That 2,000 years ago, a 33 and a half year old Jew died on two pieces of wood outside a city called Jerusalem. And that you're told that if you put your faith in it, that you would receive eternal life. It makes no sense to the intelligence of the mind. Amen. Yet for 2,000 years, man, woman, child, have embraced that truth, have bowed their knee to it, and a complete miracle has taken place on the inside of their heart where the presence of God has showed up and has begun to dispel famine in their lives. That pieces that once were missing now are filled up. The presence of God now has come to live on the inside of their hearts and has begun to change things in their life. It doesn't make any sense to the intelligent mind because you can't really see it with your physical eyes. It's the same thing as when you eat literal bread. You can't see what's happening on the inside of your body. Bread starts digestion in the mouth through salivary amylase. It starts getting broken down in the bloodstream. It turns into sugar. Sugar fuels the body, and it begins to provide nutrition for your cells to be able to operate. You can't see it with your physical eyes. Nevertheless, yet it's happening, and it's the same thing with the truth of the gospel. You can't see it, but when you put your faith in Jesus Christ and His offering of His life on the cross, it will change your life. God will intervene in the midst of your circumstances. He will begin to bring you hope. He will give you salvation. He will give you new life. But you have to want to have a relationship with Him. So no matter what you find yourself in the midst of, I got to tell you, I'm closing with this last passage. Romans 8:28. We know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose.